Well, first of all, let me express my thanks to Michael Stockenhuber for the invitation to be here and to the University of Newcastle for the opportunity to be here too. I was here 3 years ago, and at that time I talked about a different topic. The topic was photocatalysis, and we continue working in photocatalysis, that is, in a particular area of photocatalysis, trying to produce hydrogen from water splitting. But today I'm going to focus on selective oxidation. This might look a little bit like a glitzy, frivolous kind of slide, but I assure you it isn't, because in the selective and non-selective oxidation of methanol, there are two main important surface intermediates that are involved. One is just the methanol with the hydroxyl hydrogen dissociated and oxygen bound to the surface. That's the methoxy group, and this is that species partly oxidized, well on the way to CO2. It's a formate species, often bidentately bound to the surface. And as you can see here, this is a copper surface from the colour. And I'll be talking about copper for selective oxidation at the beginning part of my talk. So I just want to emphasize this point. I think in some respects, at one time, heterogeneous catalysis was considered to be a little bit of an old-fashioned subject, a little bit of a dirty subject, because close to chem-eng and close to industry and so forth. But actually what I want to emphasize in this is that heterogeneous catalysis is a nanoscience. And indeed, it's been a nanoscience since before the invention of the word nanotechnology, which was in 1974 by Taniguchi. So heterogeneous catalysts necessarily are high surface area materials. The lowest surface area of a catalyst used in industry that I know of is silver catalyst used for ethylene epoxidation. Surface area there is about 1 meter squared per gram, maybe slightly higher sometimes. But that's about the lowest. More commonly, catalysts are anywhere between 50 meters squared per gram, 100 meters squared per gram, very commonly, sometimes as much as 1,000 meters squared per gram. To get that surface area, they have to be nanomaterials. I'm sure, is everybody here a catalyst person? Yeah? So you're all very aware of this. But it's an important thing to emphasize, because nanoscience is kind of glitzy. Heterogeneous catalysis has a bit less glitz associated with it. But heterogeneous catalysis is a nanoscience, very much so. In fact, it's perhaps the most widely applied, in terms of tons of nanomaterial, nanoscience, nanotechnology that there is around. So I'll talk a little bit about that, and then go on to the main topic, selective oxidation of methanol. And I'll start by looking at a very fundamental kind of area of research, and that is looking at the reaction of methanol or oxidation of methanol on a single crystal of copper. Now, copper is not used industrially as the selective oxidation catalyst for methanol, although it was the very first catalyst, but it tends to over-oxidize pretty quickly. So it is quickly replaced by silver, and then in even more recent times, replaced by a more complex material, a mixed metal oxide, ferric molybdate, which is the main part of this talk. So powdered catalyst is the ferric molybdate work. Then go on to, if we've got time, to talk about model catalysts of this powdered system, that is iron oxide with molybdenum dosed on the surface, single crystal iron oxide. That's the right one. So let's just remind ourselves about heterogeneous catalysis. Normally, a catalyst consists of, very often they're metal particles, supported on an inert oxide. And sometimes they're not so inert. But the main role of this oxide support is to maintain these little particles as little particles, because naturally they want to sinter together to minimize surface energy. So if you, for instance, let's take an example. Our fuel in our cars is made by reforming naphtha. And before that, the source of that is oil. Lots of catalytic processes involved. The naphtha conversion catalyst, reforming catalyst that makes fuel, is a small amount of platinum on silica with various other things around. And the metal particles there are very small. They're about 1 nanometer in size, the platinum particles. The support there, the silica, is to keep. If you just use pure platinum, 1 nanometer particles, they'd sinter together very easily at very low temperatures. The support keeps them apart. But because we have this kind of interface of materials, we can expect some very different properties from the metal alone. First of all, if we have very small metal particles, they're not metallic. They become semiconducting below a certain size range. That size typically is pretty small. It varies from metal to metal, but it's around 3 nanometers. So if you take a 10 nanometer metal nanoparticle, it's pretty much metallic-like. There's still enough atoms there to have a conduction band, very similar to the bulk metal. Once you go to 3, the levels start to split out and we start to get activated electron excitation, for instance, across the Fermi level, and so they can become different. So there's one difference. We can have interaction of the metal with the support in terms of spillover, of adsorbed material from the metal to the support, or reverse spillover to the metal itself. Sometimes edge sites are the active site, where both the oxide and the metal are involved in the active site for the reaction. And a classic example of this is photocatalysis. Metal on titanium, platinum on titanium, for instance, always, it's the perimeter of those metal particles which is important, where the action takes place. And finally, depending on the nature of the support, there can be electron transfer between the support and the metal, which can affect the electronic structure and therefore reactivity of the metal significantly. So the nanoscience aspect of heterogeneous catalysis is crucial. And in my group and in the Cardiff Catalysis Institute, we like to work at this interface of three areas. We mainly deal with heterogeneous catalysis, but if we don't understand these two things to go hand in hand with that, then we struggle to understand heterogeneous catalysis properly. As I've said, it's a nanoscience. We make nanomaterials when we make catalysts. We use techniques that assess the nano properties of these materials. So nanoscience is an important aspect of what we do. In heterogeneous catalysis, the gas phase species comes into the surface and reacts. It's the composition, nature, structure of the very topmost layer of atoms which is crucial for dictating how well this thing works. The bulk can have some influence and is there necessarily often from the way you make it, but the surface layer is absolutely crucial for the reactivity. We work in a variety of areas. As I said last time, we talked about the photocatalysis. Today, I'll talk about selective oxidation, but it also involves aspects of nanofabrication, making model catalysts, surface reactivity, and I'll show you some imaging, atomic resolution imaging, molecular level imaging, using scanning tunneling microscopy. So why methanol oxidation? It's a relatively simple reaction in principle. I'm sure you guys here, or some of you, will be dealing with much more complicated molecules, trying to oxidize them. But there's several reasons for the interest in this. It's a simple molecule, methanol, obviously, but it's got a variety of possible products from oxidation. Products like formaldehyde, which is the one we're interested in, as far as this talk is concerned. Formic acid, dimethyl ether, CO2, CO, and a variety of other organic products if we consider adducts of methanol. So what we're interested in is, what is it that dictates the pathway? For instance, how do we selectively get formaldehyde in high yield and avoid combustion? Because in selective oxidation, thermodynamics always wants to push us to burn our reactant. It's the thermodynamically most favourable pathway. As well as being of practical importance, it's of theoretical, academic importance, it's of practical importance. It's involved in the industrial synthesis of formaldehyde. This is approximately 6 million tonne a year global industry. It's responsible for all of this stuff we have in our households. Urea formaldehyde resins are the basis of furniture making these days. So it's a huge business. And at the moment, there are really two catalytic routes to make formaldehyde from methanol. One uses silver catalysts, which are actually pretty low surface area. It's a silver sponge, essentially, that's used for that route. And the other is using this mixed oxide of ferric molybdate. So let's just look at what pathway is involved. And what I'm going to show you here, inside this box, is what's going on the surface of the catalyst, outside of the gas phase species. So we start with methanol and oxygen in our selective oxidation. Both can adsorb on the surface, and oxygen necessarily dissociates on the surface. relatively easily, usually, on all of these surfaces. Methanol starts by adsorbing as a molecule, weakly adsorbed to the surface. It then dissociates, usually faster in the presence of the oxygen, so the oxygen strips the hydrogen off the hydroxyl group of the methanol to make a methoxy intermediate. This is the crucial intermediate. It's the selective intermediate for making formaldehyde. So we go from there by dehydrogenation to formaldehyde, and we hope in an efficient process to get that out in 100% yield from the reaction. However, it's extremely rare to get 100% yield out of selective oxidations, because if we just take this a little bit further and insert an oxygen, we get the non-selective intermediate, the formate species. And that formate can decompose to CO2 and hydrogen, or if there's excess oxygen in this system, water is the product. Hydrogen oxidizes to water too. So there's the overall reaction we're interested in. Methanol plus a half O2, formaldehyde and water. Oxidative dehydrogenation. It's interesting to look at this pathway because there's something else in here. This is essentially the reverse of this pathway is methanol synthesis, another huge global scale industry. If we look at this from here, here's CO2 and hydrogen. We know they can make formate by the reverse process, and you can do it. If you expose a zinc oxide surface, for instance, or a copper surface to both of these, you get formate. We know we can hydrogenate the formate under the right conditions further, all the way through to methanol. So this pathway is the basis of methanol synthesis. And here's the scheme. Methanol synthesis is a very confusing, very simple reaction, but very confusing if you look at the literature. The reason it's confusing is, as I've shown here, CO2 is the microscopic agent. It's the thing that gets hydrogenated through to methanol. Here's that reaction. CO2 plus two hydrogens gives methanol, but it always leaves one oxygen behind. And obviously, if you're to carry the reaction through, you've got to remove that oxygen. Usually, hydrogen removal of that oxygen is a bit more difficult than another reaction because it involves dissociation of hydrogen and then a sequential addition of one and then two hydrogens to an oxygen atom to produce water. That rate is very slow on copper catalysts, which you use for that reaction. So instead, there's CO in there. CO is very efficient, or much more efficient than hydrogen is on copper at removing oxygen. So CO strips that oxygen off and makes CO2. So the message of that, CO2 is the microscopic synthesis agent. But the trouble is, you add those two reactions together and there's the overall reaction. The overall reaction is CO conversion. CO hydrogenation to methanol. So it's slightly confusing. CO2 is the carbon source, but CO is the overall global source for the reaction. Anyway, that's kind of a by the by. I did at one time do a lot of work on methanol synthesis when I was in industry. So what I want to start by talking about is some early work on looking at the interaction of methanol with a simple surface, copper, as I said. And this is a single crystal, copper 110. The reason we use that is because we know what the active sites are on the surface. We know the structure. Real heterogeneous catalysts are not only heterogeneous catalysts in the sense that they react gas with the solid, they're heterogeneous, they have lots of different types of sites on the surface. Quite difficult to understand which is the important one in those sites. So we often use single crystals so we know what the site looks like. So let's do a simple experiment. We'll pre-dose oxygen and then dose methanol on top. Just heat the surface up, temperature program desorption, see what comes off. But slightly cleverer than that, it's labelled oxygen that's pre-dosed to distinguish it from oxygen in the methanol. And in the methanol, we've deuterated the hydroxyl group to distinguish it from the methyl group. So you put those on at low temperature and start heating the surface. What happens? The first thing that happens is some weakly held methanol comes off at about 200K. That's not reacted. Then you see the whole of the label of the reacted species that you put on come off at about 250K. So it's weakly held, and it's a fast reaction that's produced it. So all the deuterium comes off in that, and all the oxygen that was pre-dosed comes off in that. D2O18 comes off. And what's then left on the surface decomposes at around 370 Kelvin in a peak which gives three coincident products, formaldehyde, hydrogen, and methanol, in three coincident products. That's a sign Because they come off at exactly the same temperature, they're rate limited by the decomposition of one intermediate. And if you add these things together, the stoichiometry of that intermediate is CH3O. And you can prove it's CH3O by looking at infrared, a special kind of infrared spectroscopy off the surface, where you can see the CO stretch and the methyl stretches, but no OH stretch in that unit. So from that, we get the whole mechanism. From that simple kind of experiment, we get the whole mechanism of reaction. Methanol adsorbs. It gets the hydroxyl stripped off by the oxygen that's pre-adsorbed to make OH and methoxy. Another methanol reacts with that OH to produce D2O and methoxy. This comes off at low temperatures, desorbs, leaves the methoxy on the surface. The methoxy dehydrogenates to formaldehyde and a hydrogen adsorbed on the surface. Hydrogen then has two pathways to leave the surface. It can recombine, as it does here, to hydrogen, or it can react with some of the methoxy that's on there to make methanol. So here's methanol, but it's not the same methanol that we dosed. It's a reacted methanol. So that's the pathway. There's something a bit strange about this. If you put no oxygen on the surface first, nothing happens. Methanol just adsorbs and comes off weakly. Doesn't react with the surface. But if you saturate the surface with oxygen, also, nothing happens. The methanol doesn't go on the surface, apparently. So this is with an intermediate amount of oxygen dose. Now, why is that the case? Why is it that only certain coverages of oxygen do the reaction? Well, to answer that, we need to use STM imaging. Has anybody not heard of STM? Scanning tunneling microscopy. So I hope you all sort of know the vague principles. A very weird microscopy. It's a mechanical technique in which you move a very fine metal tip across the surface and measure the electron tunneling between the tip and the surface by applying a small voltage between the tip and surface of, say, 0.1 of a volt. Amazingly, we can control the movement these days of that tip using piezo ceramics to less than an angstrom, around 0.1 of an angstrom control of X, Y, and Z movement with respect to the surface plane. And that's essential to be able to image atoms, as I'll show you in a moment. So we're going to put oxygen on this copper surface. By the way, let's just find out, what time am I supposed to finish?
Well,
3:20 for questions here. What might we expect as we put this oxygen on the surface? Well, usually when we adsorb species, we might expect random adsorption on the otherwise pristine surface in this kind of way. Or we might expect very ordered arrangements on the surface. This happens to be what we call a 2-by-1 structure on the surface, very ordered. Very often what we see is at low coverage you get something like this, but then it orders up as you go to high coverage. So that's the kind of thing we'd expect. Copper, oxygen on copper is a very unusual system. This kind of thing is what you get on most transition metals. Go to copper, something very strange happens. This is the clean copper area. And this is where the oxygen is adsorbed. We get these very long, thin islands on the surface. I'm just trying to put the scale. This is 200 angstroms by 200 angstroms. So we get these very long, thin islands. And they can be very long. And in another group, Basenbacher's group in Denmark, they've controlled this well enough to get single strings of these oxygen islands, which move around like little worms on the surface until they find another string and then lock into a straight structure. So this is very low coverage. This is a bit higher coverage. Here you can see the individual atoms in this island. And so it grows long and thin and then thickens as you put more and more oxygen on the surface. And that has important consequences for the way it reacts, as we'll see in a moment. The structure of these things is these long strings are actually not just oxygen. Something very strange happens. As the oxygen adsorbs, it pulls copper out from the surface and it makes long chains of copper and oxygen, which are a kind of pseudo-oxide material. So here's these long chains. They grow long and thin and they can thicken out as coverage gets higher and higher. And what's the structure here? Well, the structure is that this copper is fourfold coordinated. This is oxygen, that's copper. This oxygen is fourfold coordinated in all these sites, except these ones at the end, where it's threefold coordinated. So that's what these islands of oxygen look like. So let's now look at the reaction itself. And first of all, this experiment is oxygen deposited on the surface, and then methanol post-dosed, and then removed from the gas phase. This is all in ultra-high vacuum. It's very low pressures, typically 10 to the minus 7 millibar while dosing gas, 10 to the minus 10 millibar while imaging. So what you can see is those oxygen islands. This is oxygen still. So there's some islands still there after we've reacted methanol with the surface. These are oxygen islands, and here. And these things, these individual units here, are methoxy groups on the surface. Now, we don't know they're methoxy from that image, but we know from other techniques, such as infrared spectroscopy, that it's methoxy groups. And you can see they're very nicely ordered. It's actually something called P5x2. There's the 2, and there's the 5 to there. P5x2 structure. Actually, it's there. This is the unit cell, that one. P5x2, and something else to note is it's totally phase separated. You don't get any methanol in those oxygen islands themselves. They're just in where the clean copper was, is where they like to reside. That's just a blow up of that. These are individual methoxy groups, these are the oxygen atoms in the island. So that was with no methanol in the gas phase. Now let's look at what happens with methanol in the gas phase. So it's a reactive situation. And what you can see is four images in which methanol is reacting away the oxygen from the surface. The oxygen is leaving as water from the surface. And if we focus just on this island here, it gets smaller and smaller, and it's gone and replaced by methoxy groups in there. But it gets smaller in a very particular way. It never gets thinner. That thickness is the same as that, is the same as that. It shrinks from the ends, shrinks in from the ends, and is all consumed eventually. So it's these oxygens at the end of those chains which are reactive, and these oxygens here apparently are not reactive. So the methanol comes in to the surface, hydroxylates that end group, another one comes in, converts it to water, which leaves the surface. These are methoxies, and then something magic happens. I just showed... I showed something magic happening. And that was that copper atom there I showed disappearing away from the end. We know that happens. We know that once it's in that situation, that copper is not stable for whatever reason. It's got less cord. It's missing an oxygen now. But it doesn't like being in that position. It diffuses away. And we see copper grow at step edges that are on the surface. And of course, in the end, all the oxygen gets used as well. Even though here, that is not a reactive oxygen. It all gets used because when that diffuses away, that becomes an active oxygen. This is now a new active oxygen. Methanol can come in and react that oxygen, that copper diffuses away, that becomes an active oxygen. So at any one point in time, only very few of the oxygens are active sites for this reaction. But they all eventually become active sites because of this very peculiar mechanism of reaction. So those ideas are actually an important basis then for beginning to look at the real catalyst that's used for this these days. This is ferric molybdate. So I'm going to talk now about that system. So we're going to be using high area powdered catalysts that we make for the selective oxidation of methanol. They work as well as industrial ones because we've done some work with industry on these. And what we're going to develop is some rules for selective oxidation, which I think apply much more widely than this specific system we're talking about, specific system of methanol oxidation on ferric molybdate. These apply more widely. We've certainly applied it to propene oxidation on things like bismuth molybdates and iron antimonates. So I think I'm going to give you four rules, which are important ones, we believe. The industrial catalyst for this process is ferric molybdate. Ferric molybdate is this material. It's got a ratio of molybdenum to iron of 1.5. But actually, you put in excess molybdenum. There's a 2-to-1 ratio of molybdenum to iron. We can talk about why this is later. So the real catalyst is a composite material of ferric molybdate and extra MOO3 in the system. So rule one I want to tell you about is surface oxygen is the active species. What I mean by surface oxygen is surface lattice oxygen. Nothing very special about it. It's not a magical peroxide, superoxide molecule from the gas phase, or an atom that's different from the rest of the material, its surface lattice oxygen is the active species for the reaction. So what's the proof of that? Well, the proof is this. Let's just do a temperature program desorption experiment like we did on the single crystal, in which we adsorb methanol at room temperature on the catalyst where it's stable, and then heat up and see what happens. Will the catalytic reaction occur at all? There's no oxygen in the gas phase, so we might think it wouldn't. But actually, here's what happens. This is molybdena, and you see here is a peak. This is actually mass 30 in the mass spectrometer. This is done by heating up and watching what evolves with mass spectrometry. Here's mass 30 for formaldehyde. That's the only product that evolves. There's also some weakly held methanol comes off. But the product, the only product we see on molybdena, MO3, is formaldehyde. These are in just less than 200 degrees centigrade. So without any oxygen in the gas phase, we see our selected product from molybdena. Now this contrasts a lot with the other component of iron molybdate, the iron oxide. Here, this is not very clear to see, I apologise, but here is the desorption, and it's near constant desorption of hydrogen and CO2, which is a sure sign of the formate. Once you've got the formate intermediate, it decomposes to produce hydrogen and CO2 in the gas phase. No formaldehyde at all on iron oxide. So it's a combustor. That's the combustion pathway. So what happens when we combine these in ferric molybdate? Well, lo and behold, it looks very much like molybdena. There's more desorption because its area, surface area of this material is higher than molybdena is. You get more desorption, but this is in about the same place as this is. And the only product is formaldehyde. 100% selective in this TPD experiment. No gas phase oxygen. It proves conclusively that surface lattice oxygen is the important component to do these reactions. And there's another inference from this. Is it on here? Yeah. And that is, this looks very like that. Looks completely dissimilar to that. There's no signs of any formate production or burning. So the inference is that molybdenum dominates the surface in these selective oxidation catalysts. There's no iron there in them. And we'll see proof of that, sure. More proof of that, sure. I'm going to skip this. This is reactor data, which basically gives the same story. This is in the presence of oxygen. Molybdenum is very selective. Iron oxide is totally unselective, produces just CO2. Ferric molybdate is very selective. If you have the higher ratio, which is present in industrial catalysts, you can't even see this curve. There is actually a curve that goes here of conversion. It crosses at about 90% conversion, 90% selectivity. It's slightly higher, that crossover point, at about 92 for the extra molybdena that's in there. Very slight effect. The important phase is this ferric molybdate. Rule two. Most oxygen can become active surface oxygen. Just as in the copper case, there's very few active sites at the beginning, but they all become active at some point. A lot of the oxygen that's in this catalyst can become surface active oxygen. It can diffuse to the surface when we remove oxygen. So how do we know? So generally it's the case that selective oxidation catalysts are very reducible materials. They reduce quite easily. And there's good surface to bulk transport of vacancies, anion vacancies that are produced by reaction, which implies also reverse transport of oxygen anions to the surface. So what's the proof of this? Well, the proof of this is anaerobic running in methanol. What the heck happens? Will it continue making methanol after you've removed a lot of oxygen? You would think not. If that surface oxygen was crucial and nothing else happened, it should stop producing formaldehyde after a short period of time. Well, this shows it doesn't stop producing formaldehyde. It certainly changes. So this is experiments in which we're running in anaerobically at high temperature. This is 250. Putting in 1 microliter shots of liquid methanol over the surface and watching what happens. Well, what happens is that formaldehyde selectivity goes down, but doesn't go to zero, it goes to about 50%, and CO starts to be produced after you've reduced the surface quite a bit. But it's still producing a lot of methanol, even after the selectivity is still high, after 2 monolayers equivalent of oxygen have been removed from the catalyst, because every time you make formaldehyde, you remove a water. You move oxygen as water into the gas phase. We've removed 2 monolayers here. Here we've removed 10. Still performing not too bad. And the activity is very high. methanol conversion is here. It's dropped to 20 to 10%. If we look at 330, if we push it a bit more, inject a lot more methanol at a higher temperature, conversion here is very high, near 100%, and it still operates. The selectivity to methanol has gone down, CO is higher, but you see after a lot's been removed, we start to make CO2. It's probably a sure sign that iron is coming out to the surface as we do this real reduction. But you can see we've removed 40 monomers equivalent of oxygen in that experiment, which is about a tenth of all the oxygen is still doing catalysis, even after all that time. Rule three, preferential cation segregation occurs and is crucial to catalytic efficiency. Now, how do we know that's the case? I already said that the TPD data and reactor data infer molybdenum prefers to be at the surface. This is proof of it by scanning transmission electron microscopy and using EELs as chemical analysis. So what we do here is, besides imaging catalyst particles, we can also scan up one nanometer probe across the surface and measure the chemical information using EELs. And what we find is enhancement of molybdenum at the edge and depletion of iron at the edge. So it's enriched, as we expect, in molybdenum in the surface layer. Rule four, the highest oxidation state is the selective one. So this is ferric molybdate. We know it's molybdenol at the surface. Moly 6 plus, we believe, is the active site for doing this reaction. It's the selective site. And there's a simple proof here, a lot of information. I want you to focus on only one curve, and that's these black dots. These black dots are the selectivity to formaldehyde over molybdenum dioxide. So this is 4 plus molybdenum, effectively. So what happens? Well, it's not very good, for a start. As we go to a higher temperature, so the formaldehyde selectivity goes down. For MOO3, the equivalent here is about 90-90. 90% conversion, 90% selectivity. Probably even a bit higher than 90% selectivity. This is lower. So MOO2 immediately we see is not as good. But also something very strange happens here. If you follow this curve as we heat it up, it goes down and down in selectivity and then goes up again in selectivity. Now, we don't expect that from these kinds of processes. Normally, selectivity just goes down as you increase the temperature and make more and more CO2. The reason that happens is it converts to MOO3. As we go up in temperature, add around 300 C or so, it takes up quite a lot of oxygen and converts the MOO2 to MOO3, 6 plus, and that's better. It's more selective. 6 plus is the important oxidation state for the reaction. And it's also worth noting that in patents, it's crucial. A thing that's stressed in patents is there's excess oxygen at the end of the bed. And the reason for that is to make sure you keep the catalyst in the 6 plus oxidation state of molybdenum. If you let the oxygen go to get completely converted by the end of the bed, which usually you would like for maximum efficiency, if you let it be completely converted, you start losing selectivity because you make moly 4 plus. So if all that's true, surely we could get away with using just one monolayer of molybdenum. We said molybdenum is the important species. Why not just make catalysts with one monolayer only of molybdenum? And when it comes to ferric molybdate, the big cost item is the molybdenum. Iron's cheap. Molybdenum's moderately expensive. So if you could make iron oxide with one monolayer of molybdenum, that would be brilliant. So this actually isn't monolayers, but this is, we'll come on to that shortly. This is low levels of molybdenum in a bulk preparation of material. And what you see is, this is 0.02, 2% molybdenum in the formulation. You see essentially what you see with iron oxide, that's a lot of CO2 production. But we start to see CO being produced, which isn't there for iron oxide. Go a little bit higher, 5% molybdenum. The formate, CO2 production's gone down, CO2 has gone up, and we're starting to see already a little bit of formaldehyde production. And by the time we get to 0.5 to 1, remember the ferric molybdate is 1.5 to 1, so it's a third of the maximum, we no longer get any CO2, so the CO2 is knocked out quite early. We start to get a lot of formaldehyde and still also quite a bit of CO. So low molybdenum means CO production, and we believe that CO production is from isolated sites of iron. If you calculate the site distribution on the surface on a random basis, if you calculate what happens to the sites as you increase the molybdenum, B is the molybdenum coverage on the surface, this is what happens to pairs of iron sites, this is what happens to pairs of molybdenum sites, and this is what happens to mixed isolated sites of each. These go down fast, this increases at the high loading, and in between you get single sites. So we believe it's these single sites which are responsible for CO production. Here's the same graph, except this is mole fraction of molybdenum. You do get a maximum for CO in that mole fraction. Formaldehyde goes up at the high loading. CO2 production goes down very fast, with small amounts of molybdenum added. So it seems to be even more critical than this. This is a random basis. If the molybdenum goes on in an ordered fashion, it knocks out dual sites of iron more quickly than that theoretical curve would say. If we put monolayers now, take iron oxide and put monolayers of molybdenum on top of that, here's iron itself and here's increasing amounts of molybdenum on the surface in monolayers, small amounts of a monolayer, here three monolayers. What happens is it actually activates the catalyst. The catalyst gets more active. This is conversion here, this side, and these are selectivity. Selectivity goes up significantly, even with very small amounts of molybdenum on the surface. And that's because we knock out the CO2 production pretty quick. If we put these monolayers on, we can do a similar kind of experiment. This now isn't STEM, it's TEM, high resolution TEM across an iron oxide core with a thin layer, in this case three monolayers of molybdenum on the surface. Here's the iron signal, here's the molybdenum signal enhanced at the edges of the particle. So again, the molybdenum stays at the surface. This has been calcined to 500 centigrade. We've put the molybdenum on by incipient wetness, dried it, calcined it to 500. The molybdenum stays at the surface. It doesn't disappear into the bulk. So it likes to be at the surface of this material. So to summarise all that catalyst work, there's a number of points. I'm not going to go through them all. This is perhaps the most important one. In this catalyst, the surface is totally dominated by molybdenum, and that's important because it's molybdenum that's the selective agent for this reaction. So let's now try and make model catalysts. Why do we make model catalysts? Well, one of the reasons is we can see the sites, or we hope to be able to see the sites, and ultimately be able to identify the active site during the reaction. So how are we going to do this? How do we make these kind of catalysts? Well, in this area of work, most people work with metal particles on an oxide, and there are two methods of doing that. One is to deposit particles on the surface of a bulk oxide, which is fine, but if we're using scanning tunneling microscopy, we rely on electron tunneling. It's got to be a conductive support for that to work. And not that many materials work. Alumina won't, it's an insulator. This is an example of our work of palladium nanoparticles, about 4 nanometers, on titania, and we can atomically resolve the titania. Titania is a good enough semiconductor to be conductive enough to enable that to take place. But you couldn't do that on alumina. So another approach is to put a thin layer of an oxide on a metal support. So you can make conducting alumina layers in that way and put particles on them. We collaborate with the Fritz Haber Institute in Berlin. We do this kind of experiment on iron oxide. Iron oxide does turn out to be conductive enough to get STM images of these things, whereas the Fritz Haber make these thin layers and put other material on those. Here's an example of an oxide that we made, but barium oxide is an insulator. You can't make a crystal of it and image it by STM, but you can make a thin layer on platinum 111 and get images of it. So we put molybdenum on in a specific way. You can put it on by heating a hot molybdenum filament to very high temperature, but a better alternative is to control it, put molybdenum oxide down directly rather than put molybdenum metal and then oxidize. If you put molybdenum down, it tends to pull oxygen out of the lattice and make a mess of the lattice. But if you evaporate this in oxygen, it evaporates at lower temperatures. Here's a plot of molybdenum signal after a certain time of dose at different pressures of oxygen in the gas phase, going up to about 1 times 10 to the minus 5 millibar, and you can see the amount of molybdenum goes up as you increase the pressure. The reason is a hot molybdenum filament makes molybdenum oxide on the surface, and molybdenum oxide is more volatile, a lot more volatile than molybdenum metal is. So it evaporates quite well. The XPS here shows that it goes down as molybdenum 6 plus, which is the one we want. So that's molybdenum 6 plus on the surface of our iron oxide single crystal. This is imaging the surface layer, and I'm not going to go through all of this. I want you to focus on this one. This is low coverage, and this is just a blow up of this part of the surface here. And what you can see is atomic resolution, just about. This is the iron oxide surface here. And we can see the iron cations in the surface. You can see them at atomic resolution. And these are clusters of molybdenum. These are individual clusters. These are islands of clusters. We know they're clusters because these things are a lot bigger than atomic dimensions. I think it's a higher resolution image here. So here's the iron cations. Here's individual units of molybdenum oxide. And here's an ordered array. An island of these things. And we can measure the distances. This is what we expect. Across this line here is the spacing of the iron cations that we'd expect, 6 angstroms. And here, this is double the spacing. So this is actually a 2x2 structure, twice the lattice spacing of the support. And if you look carefully, you see that there's usually double peaks in there as we go across these units. You might even see a little hole in there. So it seems like this is some kind of little donut shape on the surface. And what we believe it is MO309. This is MO309. It's a cycle, a six-membered cycle of oxygen and molybdenum with three bridging oxygens, three molybdenums, and two terminal oxygens on each, two double bond oxygens on each molybdenum as well. If you look at the old literature, from the 60s, there's a lot of work on evaporation of oxides from metal filaments. And what's found there is that usually the molybdenum doesn't come off as MO3, as a monomer. It usually comes off as clusters of units of a range of sizes which depend on the oxygen pressure and temperature at which you evaporate. But when you do it at a very low pressure, the dominant species is MO309. You can see it mass spectrometrically. So there's a lot of work went on there in that area. So this is what we believe comes off our filament, predominantly, and it's responsible for those features we see in the SDM. The only parallel work around is from Pacific Northwest Lab, where they put tungsten oxide on a titania surface, and they identified W309 on the surface. These are the little units. They look slightly different from what I've shown you. There's a middle hole and material around it. They look slightly different because these things are tilted on the surface. Ours, we believe, are flat. They're tilted into troughs, which are present in the structure on the surface. So this is what we believe we have. Monomers of this MO309 unit deposited on the surface. That we can see the registry with the surface. So the centre of that MO309 cluster sits right on top of an iron 3 plus cation. And then they arrange themselves in a 2x2 structure. Here's one iron, two irons, one iron, two irons. So it's 2x2. Array. So, how do these things react? Can we measure the reactivity? Well, it's difficult, but we can do it. Here's the clean iron oxide surface. We do TPD in the same ways as I've shown you before, and what we see come off is predominantly CO2. There is some CO comes off as well. This is a single pass experiment now. It's a TPD in a vacuum system from a crystal of iron oxide. There is CO comes off as well as CO2, but no formaldehyde. We then put molybdenum onto it, anneal it to 700C, put methanol on, and lo and behold, we get formaldehyde. This is a formaldehyde peak down here, and there's a second one up here. We still get CO and CO2 coming off. And no matter how much molybdenum we put down in this treatment, we still get CO and CO2. So it's not quite like the real catalyst system. And the reason we believe that's the case is this. What we think happens is that when we put a thin shell of molybdena on either a catalytic material, a powdered iron oxide, or a single crystal of iron oxide, what we make after annealing is ferric molybdane, a thin shell of ferric molybdane. But we believe in that material we have both iron and molybdenum present in the surface layer. We put more molybdenum on, that shell simply gets thicker. If we put enough on, and we can't in the experiments we do, there's not enough material on the surface, but if we put enough on, we believe we convert the hole including that core of iron oxide, finally, to ferric molybdate. That still, we believe, would not be good enough because the surface is ferric molybdate, and we believe there's a mix of iron and molybdenum there. Iron makes CO and CO2. It's only when we put a little bit of excess of molybdenum in the surface, if we now have that saturated ferric molybdate, put a bit of molybdenum on, lo and behold, it stays there, we believe, and then makes the selective material. So let me come to some conclusions. First of all, it's surface oxygen, which is the active selective oxidant in this reaction. Most of that oxygen in the whole material can become surface oxygen by diffusion. If you remove a lot of the oxygen, the selectivity goes down, but it still stays active as a catalyst. Preferential cation segregation occurs, not just for this system with molybdenum at the surface, but in iron antimonate, for instance, which is another kind of selective oxidation catalyst. Antimony prefers to be at the surface. Bismuth molybdate, molybdenum prefers to be at the surface. Iron vanadate, vanadium prefers to be at the surface, and so on. The mixed surface layer produces formaldehyde, but also CO or CO2, depending how much iron's around. So high selectivity is only obtained with a molybdenum-only surface layer. The highest oxidation state is the selective one. And these model catalysts offer us the potential, if we can do the fabrication line, to see the active site. That is, put methanol and oxygen on together on the oxide and see where they react and see what the preferred sites are. We've not got to that yet. That's an ambition for the future. Just to give some acknowledgements, in recent times we've had support from Diamond Synchrotron in the UK and from the Royal Society for some lab refurbishment. Cardiff itself, Perstorp, is the industrial company which is the leader in ferric molybdate catalysis in the world, and this is the UK funding agency who funded a lot of these people. Two people in particular have been heavily involved in the work recently. That's Kath Brooks and Peter Wells here. And so I thank them for their efforts in this direction too. And I thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.